Жила как у парики.
Да.
Жила в рулетке.
Да.
Ом намо Бхагавате Васудевая. Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 4, Chapter 27, which is called Attack by Chandravega on the City of King Puranjana, the character of Kalakanya. And today we will read text number 10. Teshu Tadritka Harishu,
Teshu Tadritka Harishu,
Griha Kashanu Jivishu. Гриха кашану дживишу, нирудхина мама твена, вишаешван бадхаята. Please repeat.
Тешу тат рикта Харешу,
Тешу Тадрита Харешу,
Гриха Кошану Дживишу, Нирутхена Маматвена,
Вишаешван Вапатьята.
Вот
translation. Тешу,
Тешу,
Тозен,
Тозен,
Татрикта Харишу,
The plunderers of his money,
Гриха,
Хоу,
Коша,
Treasury.
Ануджи вишу, to the followers. Нирудхена,
deep rooted.
Маматвена,
by attachment.
Вишаешу, to sense objects.
Анва бадхьята,
became bound. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace Srila Prabhupada Srila Prabhupada Ki. These sons and grandsons were ritually plundered of King Puranjana riches, including his home, treasury, servants, secretaries and all other paraphernalia.
Puranjana's attachment for these things was very deep rooted. But in this word, the word Viktaharishu, meaning plunderers of wealth, is very significant. One's sons, grandsons, and other descendants are ultimately plunderers of one's accumulated wealth. There are many celebrated businessmen and industrialists who produce great wealth and are highly prized by the public, but all their money is ultimately plundered by their sons and grandsons. In India, we have actually seen one industrialist who, like King Puranjana, was very much sexually inclined and had a half dozen wives. Each of these wives had a separate establishment that necessitated the expenditure of several thousands of rupees. When I was engaged in talking with him, I saw that he was very busy trying to secure money so that all his sons and daughters would get at least 500,000 rupees each. Thus, such industrialists, businessmen, or karmis are called mudhas in the Shastras. They work very hard, accumulate money, and are satisfied to see that this money is plundered by their sons and grandsons. Such people do not want to return their wealth to their actual owner. As stated in Bhagavad Gita 5:29, Bhaktaram Yagya Tapasam Sarvaloka Maheshwar, the real proprietor of all ways is Supreme Personality of Godhead. He is the actual enjoyer. So-called earners of money are those who simply know tricks by which they can take away God's money under the guise of business and industry. After accumulating this money, they enjoy seeing it plundered by their sons and grandsons. This is the materialistic way of life. In materialistic life, one is encaged within the body and deluded by false egoism. Thus, one thinks, I am this body, I am a human being, I am an American, I am an Indian. This bodily conception is due to false ego. Being deluded by false ego, one identifies himself with a certain family, nation, or community. In this way, one's attachment for the material world grows deeper and deeper. Thus, it becomes very difficult for the living entity to extricate himself from this attachment. Such people are graphically described in the 16th chapter of Bhagavad Gita in this way. Idam adhyamaya labdham imam prapsye manoradham idam astidam apime barishyati punarthanam asau maya hadashatru ханишье капаранапи ишварохам ахам боги ситхохам балаван сухи адьём гаджанаванасми коньюсти садро садришо маям якшье дашьями мадишья ити агьянави мотах. The translation. The demonic person thinks, so much wealth do I have today, and I will gain more according to my chance. So much is mine now, and it will be increased in the future, more and more. He is my enemy, and I have killed him, and my other enemy will also be killed. I am the lord of everything. I am the enjoyer. I am perfect, powerful, and happy. I am the richest man, surrounded by aristocratic relatives. There is no so powerful and happy as I am. I shall perform sacrifices. I shall give some charity, and thus I shall rejoice. In this way, such persons are deluded by ignorance. And what will, in this way, people engaged in various laborious activities and their attachment for body, home, family, nation, and community becomes more and more deep-rooted. End of purpose. Om Agyana Temirandasya Gyananjanan Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Шри Чайтанья Манобиштам Стхапитам Йена Бутале Своям Рупах Кадамах Ям Дадати Свападантикам Нитьянанда Хам Науми Сарвананда Карам Парам Харинама Прадам Девам Авадута Широмани Нама Махава Даньяя Кришна Према Прадаяте Кришная Кришна Чайтанья Намне Горд Вишена Махам Нилачалани Васая Нитьяя Параматмане Балабхадра Субхадрабхьям Шри Джаганатхе Те Намаха Хе Кришна Каруна Синдо Динабанда Джагатпате Гопиша Гопика Канта Радха Канта Намастуте Тапта Канчана Гуранги Радхе Вриндаванешвари Вришабану Суте Деви Пранамами Хари Прие Ванча Калпата Рубьяща Крипа Синдубья Эвача Патита нам паване бьо, вайшнаве бьо намо намаха, чай Шри Кришна, чай Танья, Прабху Нитьянанда, Шри Гададхара, Шри Васади Гоура, Бхакта Вринда, Харе Кришна, 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 Харе Харе, Харе Рама, 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 Харе Харе, Харе Кришна, 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 Харе Харе, Харе Рама, 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 Харе Харе, Харе Кришна, 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 Харе Харе, Харе Рама, 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 Харе Харе. Намо Вишну Падая Кришна, Штата Лишимати Бхакти Вигьян Госвамити. Бхакти Вигьян Асамритам Рада Мада Васавинам Хридиху Маучата Тама Падашикам Намамехам. Намо Вишну Падая Кришна, Штата Лишимати Бхакти Веданта Свами Мединамине. Намасте Сарасвати Дева Гурвани Прачарине. Нирвишиша Шуньявади Пашчат Ядеша Тарине. Янтах Правишья Мама Вача Мамам Прасуптам. Санджива Ятя Кила Шакти Дарах Свадамна. Аньявшча Хаста Чарана Шравана Твагадин. Прана намо Бхагавате Пурушая Тубьям. Чтобы прославить Господа чистыми речами, рассказывайте все, что услышал свой духовный учитель и сумел усвоить, хотя я не способен. Иначе до речи, которыми я, наверное, так и остался бы оскорблен. So once more verse. These sons and grandsons were literally plundered of King Puranjana riches, including his home, treasury, servants, secretaries, and all other paraphernalia. Puranjana's attachment for these things were very deep-rooted. So we seen that Puranjana was simultaneously attachment for two things together. The first thing was his treasure. He was attachment to his treasure, including his home, servants, and so on, and other paraphernalia. And the other attachment was the attachment to his sons, grandmother, grandsons, and other descendants. So he has two attachments very deep-rooted, and it was a problem of his life. We know that attachments is our problem, all of us. And in this in his commentary, Srila Prabhupada quoted a part of 16th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, very interesting chapter about saint and demonic persons. And the most interesting that this way of thinking is as most of people think this way. Maybe not so graphically and bright as it was described, but in this direction, and I think most of us also think in this direction, that most of people want to be active, successful, useful in society. Even devotees want to be active, successful, and useful in society. And one time, years ago, Guru Maharaj once gave Bhagavad Gita to one of his non-devotee friend. And later, he asked him about his impression of Bhagavad Gita. And Maharaj's friend answered, "I liked only one chapter, number 16. It's about me." And and what will happen if we will think as was described in this 16th chapter of Bhagavad Gita? And Srila Prabhupada answers. in the last part of commentary. In this way, people engaged in various laborious activities, and their attachment for body, home, family, nation, and community becomes more and more deep-rooted. So our attachments are very, very deep-rooted. And in this way, people engage in various laborious activities, and their attachments for body, home, family, nation, and community becomes more and more deep-rooted. In most religions, attachment to the family, country, children is encouraged. For example, Christianity. And also, for most Hindus, Grihametha is not a dirty word. It's a very nice word. Why? What does Grihametha literally mean? Listen to the definition of word Grihametha. Grihametha, this is one who performs the domestic rites or sacrifices to live happily together with his family. It's very nice. For most of religious, it's a very nice activity. And is it bad or is it good? It depends on what we are looking for. For living within this material world, it is very good to be Grihametha. But we have another goal. Srila Prabhupada gave us another goal, to live this material world. And for achieving this goal, attachment for body, home, family, nation, etc., is very, very bad. It's disqualification for way of bhakti. Why? Srila Prabhupada answered why. Because by this attachment for body, we become more and more deep-rooted to bodily conception of life. And this analogy of King Purajana very brightly shows us how living being is plunged more and more to material existence, and what be a result of this. This analogy is not a long, boring story. This is the longest story by the greatest sage Narada in Srimad Bhagavatam. And it's no coincidence. If we read it with great attention, we will understand that we really are not this body, and this world is not a place for living. Even if we think that we are happy and successful in our life with our relatives, King Puranjana also was happy, and Prachina Barhishat was also happy. But it is not such kind of happiness which we really need. And this verse is about sons, grandsons, and others. In purport to the previous verse, verse number 9, Srila Prabhupada explains allegorical meaning of sons and grandsons in this history. Maybe you remember from the previous lecture what is the allegorical meaning of sons and grandsons. Maybe you remember from yesterday. It was in the purport of Srila Prabhupada. In this allegory, sons and grandsons are actions and reactions which we create by our activity, both pious and unpious. So sons and grandsons are such reactions and action. It's a very interesting analogy. But today, in this purport, Srila Prabhupada speaks not allegorically, he speaks directly what are children in our life, yes? And the allegory that children and grandchildren are actions and reactions is in line with the philosophical definition of children. Do you remember what is the philosophical definition of children? In the mean of six changes of body during the life, yes?
Byproducts,
yes, very nice. We know that we have six changes, yes, during our life. This birth, then maturity, yes, then byproducts, then disease, old age, and death. This is six. These are well-known six changes during life of all humans being, and not only human being, but also all beings. But if we talk about children in a dry philosophical language as byproducts without Vaishnava compassion, it will be so cynical. I think you agree with this. Children are very important, both in Vedic culture and in modern life. Most of people want to have children. I remember I also want to have children very, very much. And why people want to have children? Because they expect some pleasure from children, something new in boring life. In Vedic times, the sun supported the stay of the ancestors in the heavenly planets through the Shraddha ceremony. In our time, people hope that the child will be the creature who will love them, who will give a sense into our existence. If we are not successful in something, we hope that the child will be successful, or grandchild will be successful. That is the way how this world works. Maya always gives us hope for happiness and success. When we are young, we hope to be happy, and the world seems beautiful and wonderful for us. Then we became disappointed, but we have a baby, and we hope to be happy again through that baby. It doesn't work again. Then a grandson is born, and we hope now to be definitely become happy through the grandsons. And so life passed in illusory hopes. If a person does not have children, he considers himself very unhappy. We knew some examples from Srimad Bhagavatam. Nanda and Yashoda lament that they have no son. King Chitrageta also lamented that he had no son. But everything is not so simple. Children don't away bring joy. We know in our own experience that children are not joy. And also we have some examples in Bhagavatam. First of all, parents have a very big responsibility. King Rishabhadeva speaks about this in his instructions to his 100 sons. Guru nasasya, svajano nasasya, pita nasasya, janani nasasya, daivam natasya napатишся, sasyam namочает ях самопетам ритюм. It's a very nice verse which says that Gurur Nasasyat, the person cannot become a guru, the person cannot become a father, mother, and worship demigods if this person cannot deliver his dependence from the path of repeated birth and death. When I have a child, I have no mind about this. And most of people don't recognize such a big responsibility to be parents. Actually, one can begot children only in two purposes: to give a liberation to Jiva, or to born a preacher for spreading Krishna consciousness all over the world. There are the only two purposes, if we can do it. And Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati Thakur is called Ray of Vishnu because he is a very, very big preacher of Krishna consciousness all over the world. And Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati Thakur said that he would be a father of 100 children if they were devotees of the Lord. But in Kali Yuga, this is impossible, so he remains brahmachari. It's a very famous from Srila Bhaktivinoda Sarasvati Thakur, very, very famous words of Srila Bhaktivedanta Sarasvati Thakur. Even great personalities had problems with their children. For example, King Anga, father of King Vena. This history is described in this fourth chapter, canton. The King Anga was the father of King Vena, and Vena from the very beginning was very, very cruel. After fixing his bow and arrow, the cruel boy, Vena, the son of King Anga, used to go to the forest and kill innocent deers. And as he came, all the people would cry, "Here comes cruel Vena, here comes cruel Vena." The boy was so cruel that while playing with young boys of his age, he would kill them as if they were animals. After seeing the cruel and the behavior of his son, King Anga punished him in different ways to reform him, but was unable to bring him to the path of gentleness. He thus became greatly aggrieved. The king thought to himself, "Persons who have no son are certainly fortunate." Yes, it's very interesting that in the beginning we want to have children, but after we see that persons who have no children are certainly fortunate. I feel the same in my life also. They must have worshipped the Lord in the previous lives so that they would not have to suffer the unbearable unhappiness caused by a bad son. A sinful son causes a person's reputation to vanish. His irregular activities at home cause irreligion and quarrel among everyone, and this creates only endless anxiety. Who, if he is considerate and intelligent, would desire such a worthless son? Such a son is nothing but a bond of illusion for the living entity, and he makes one's home miserable. And then King Anga changed his thought. Please listen. Then the king thought, "A bad son is better than a good son." Why?
Maybe he wouldn't be so much attached.
Yes. A bad son is better than a good son because a good son creates an attachment for home, whereas a bad son does not. A bad son creates a hellish home from which an intelligent man naturally becomes very easily detached. So it's a way how devotees think. The King Anga was a great devotee of Lord. And even the best, there was a situation is a nice situation for devotee. Every situation is nice situation for devotee. Thinking like that, King Anga could not sleep at night. He became completely indifferent to household life. Once, in the dead of night, he got up from the bed and left his wife, who was sleeping deeply. He gave up all attraction for his greatly opulent kingdom, and unseen by anyone, he very silently gave up his home and opulence and proceeded toward the forest. So, due to his cruel son Vena, King Anga became renounced from material life. Also, we know Advaita Acharya. He's a big Acharya in our Sampradaya. And Advaita Acharya was an incarnation of whom? Sadashiva and Mahavishnu, yes. And he had six sons. Shri Achyutananda, Shri Krishna, Shri Gopal, Balaram, Swarupa, and Jagadish. The most famous among them was Achyutananda. Balaram, Swarupa, and Jagadish became Mayavadis. So three sons of Advaita Acharya were bad sons. Three sons of Also, Srila Prabhupada had five children, three sons, Prayag Raj, Madhura Mohan, and Vrindavan Chandra, and two daughters, Sulakshmana and Bhaktilata. And no one of them became Vaishnavas, we know. So, the life is so. Also, we know one of the first disciples of Srila Prabhupada, Shyamasundara and Malati. And Shyamasundara and Malati was the first family in ISKCON. And they have a daughter, Saraswati. Srila Prabhupada liked this small girl very, very much. He walked with her, he played with her. And Srila Prabhupada said that Saraswati is a very nice preacher. You know that Saraswati approached different person and asked, "Who is Krishna?" And then she explained them who is Krishna. And Srila Prabhupada was very, very highly satisfied with her behavior and her preaching. But now Saraswati didn't become Vaishnavi. He didn't become Vaishnavi. Now she is a friend of ISKCON. His Grace Chaitanya Chandra Charan Prabhu, this is spiritual master from Russia, conducted research and came to the conclusion that only 2% of children of devotees become real devotees. This is a very pity result. Maybe now this figure is bigger because we know Mataji Yamuna, Mataji Devashri Radhika, and other devotees who are very real devotees from devotee families, but it like truth. In Dnieper temple in Ukraine, children of most devotees don't practice. They really don't practice. My own children were in temple in childhood, but now they are non-devotees. And also of the topmost senior devotees of our temple, their daughters also are not devotees. And it's a very, very pity result, but this is such a result. For most people in Kali Yuga, their children in this life were their enemies in previous lives. It's a very interesting statement that in Kali Yuga, in India, people have very nice karma, but in Western countries, especially in Ukraine, Russia, our children are our enemies from previous lives. So they have very, yes, it's really this. And it's very difficult life because now these enemies have a very bad behavior according to their parents. And I have this situation in my family. It's really very, very difficult situation. And due to this, family life became a hell. For devotees, such situation is favorable. It leads to renunciation. We already spoke about Srila Prabhupada and King Vena, which one of reason of their renunciation was their nice family life. And I like to finish my lecture with one more very interesting history of parents and son from Srimad Bhagavatam. It was the first history from Srimad Bhagavatam which I heard in the very beginning of my practice. And this is the history of King Chitraketu, the history of the sixth canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. We know that King Chitraketu had no son, and he almost was crazy about this. He lamented about this. And Angira Muni one time came to his kingdom to give King Chitraketu Divya Gyan, or spiritual knowledge. But the great sage saw that King Chitraketu's mind was absorbed in material things, very deeply absorbed in material things. And Angira Muni gave him only a son. So it's a very interesting point that when Jai Shri Shri Jagannathi Subhadra Jai Shri Shri Gauranitai. It's a very interesting point. When we are deeply attached to material life, we can hear spiritual knowledge. So the first qualification to become a devotee is not be attached deeply to material things, but King Chitraketu was very, very deep in spiritual life, in material life, and so Angira Muni gave him only a son, but not a spiritual knowledge. And this son caused jubilation and lamentation to King Chitraketu. All of us, I think, know this history. It's very, very interesting history. The main history of Ritrasura is the main history in all Srimad Bhagavatam. And the co-wives of Kritadyuti was mother of son, Chitraketu's son, were envious because they had no child, and they poisoned the child. Chitraketu was overwhelmed by shock at his son's death. And when the great sages Angira understood that the king was almost dead in an ocean of lamentation, he went there with Narada Rishi. Angira and Narada Rishi came to relieve the king from excessive lamentation by instructing him about the spiritual significance of life. It's also very significant and interesting point that they pacify King Chitraketu not by some material things, but by spiritual life. And they very directly said about spiritual things to King Chitraketu. But in this moment, King Chitraketu was ready to understand spiritual life. But before it was impossible for him to understand anything from spiritual life. The great saints Angira and Narada explain that the relationship between father and son is not factual. It is simply a representation of the illusory energy. The relationship did not exist before, nor will it stay in the future. By the arrangement of time, the relationship exists only in the present, and we must understand that all our relationships, body relationship, are only in the present. They were not before and will be not after. One should not lament for temporary relationships. By a temporary arrangement, a father begets a child or a living entity becomes the child of so-called father. This temporary arrangement is made by the Supreme Lord. Neither the father nor the son exist independently. When one searches for happiness in matter, one must certainly lament for bodily relationships. Self-realization means spiritual realization on one's relationship with Krishna. Such realization ends one's miserable material life. So we can end our miserable material life only by understanding of our relationship with Krishna, but not with relationship with our relatives and friends and so on. As the king listening to the great sages, he was revealed from his false lamentation. Srila Prabhupada explained in purport that son of Chitraketu was his enemy in previous life. It is very interesting explanation. So he died very quickly to a great bring pain and lamentation to his father in his life and enemy in previous. To strengthen the king's renunciation, Chitraketu was able to talk with his dead son. This is very interesting episode. Sri Narada Muni said, "O living entity, all good fortune unto you. Just see your father and mother. All your friends and relatives are overwhelmed with grief because of your passing away." So we see that by the mystic power of Narada Muni, the living entity re-entered his dead body for a short time and spoke in reply to Narada Muni's request. So Narada Muni asked this living entity to re-enter the dead body, and this living entity re-entered the dead body, and there was a conversation between Narada Muni and this living entity. Living entity said, "According to the results of my activities, I, the living being, transmigrate from one body to another, sometimes going to the spices of the demigods, sometimes to the spices of lower animals, sometimes among the vegetables, and sometimes to the human spices." So is our way. We transmigrating from one spices to another. "Therefore, in which birth were this my mother and father? Please imagine how it is to hear from his child, from which birth were these two, my mother and father. No one is actually my mother and father. How can I accept these two people as my parents?" The living entity is eternal and imperishable, because he actually has no beginning and no end. He never takes birth or dies. He is the basic principle of all types of bodies. Yet he does not belong to the bodily category. So this is what this died son say as a living entity. For this living entity, no is dear, no is anyone unfavorable. He makes no distinction between that which is his own and that which belongs to anyone else. He is one without a second. In other words, he is not affected by friends or enemies, well-wishers or mischief-mongers. He is only an observer, a witness of the different qualities of man. So it's also a very interesting statement that we are only an observer. We are only a witness of the different qualities of man. Our really position. When the conditional soul, Jiva, in the form of Maharaja Chitraketu's son, had spoken in this way and then left, Chitraketu and the other relatives of the dead son were all astonished. Thus they cut off the shackles of their affection, which was due to their relationship with him, and gave up their elimination. So all events of human life can bring us close to Godhead if we understand them in a proper way. There I want to end this lecture, so maybe you have some questions or want to say something in addition to all this.
Thank you very much for your lecture. I was thinking about the point that you said that it's actually our duty to bring our children back home, right? And as you said, many, many devotees didn't have children who became devotees. So how can we not feel very, very guilty at the end of time when our children don't do what we like them to do? And this is my first question, and my second question is what can we do that the children will get devotees?
No, the first question. Most of us are not great devotees, yes? And we have a very, very bad karma, most of us. And devotee and children are a result of our karma. It's a very deep karma, children. And so to have a nice children is a good karma. And we see it in India, where now the relationships between parents and children are very good and astonishing for us, for example. But when and of course, the first thing that Prabhupada asked devotees to do is garbhadana samskara. We know it, that we must have spiritual procedure for begot children. And Prabhupada asked to read about 50 rounds of mantra before this, and also to obtain blessings from senior devotees and so on. This is really spiritual procedure, because all depends of this, of the condition of mind, and which soul will be born depends on the condition of man and woman in this moment. But even the best devotees in our temple, of course, I think have this procedure, garbhadana samskara, but both their child are very, very difficult even for regular people, not even for devotees. And I thought about them, about this, why it happens, and both of them, both Mataji and Prabhu, they had a very, very dirty life before they became devotees. They were druggers and so on, and it's a very dirty life. So they have children as they have. But I also asked my Guru Maharaj, when my child was small, I asked my Guru Maharaj, maybe I must go to Mayapur and educate him in Gurukula, but my Guru Maharaj said it will be worse than it is now. And he was really right in time, I understand it. And what we can do, we must do all our best to our child when they are small. What we can do to them. But when they became teenagers, there will be their own choice to become devotee or to become regular people. And it happens with most of children of devotees. From teenagers, they change their behavior. But I expect that in future my children will become devotee, because they are not regular people, not as a regular people, because they have some habits, not as in material world, and they have some difficulties to live in material world with some these habits. And no, all material enjoyment is not the biggest enjoyment for them. Maybe they don't understand that, but I saw them and I understand that simple material happiness is not the ultimate happiness for them. It's my hope they in time they will understand. So I think maybe most of devotees of children, devotees children in future will change their behavior to devotees. And we also have one example in our temple. One of children of our devotees, as a teenager, he was, it was a very, very difficult son, a very difficult son. But his father allow him to go his own way. And these children these children did a lot of very bad sins, a lot of very strange sins. But in time, maybe in 10 years, he changed his behavior, and now he's a nice devotee. This example very nice for me. It's my hope that in time my children maybe also do that. So it's my answer to the first question. And the freedom of choice is the main thing which we must have. We must give to our children, because the Lord always give us a choice. So the Lord can force us to be devotees, yes? It's not difficult for him, but he always gives us a choice. And the second, maybe I also answer the second question, that of course devotees must be very conscious about children, must have very conscious, very pure consciousness, and very sattvic situation must be. It's very important. And then they must give them all devotional mood that they can when children are small. But then they must give them a choice and to live his own life, I think. Because I also saw some children with their parents forced to be devotees. And now they are in a very miserable condition, because they are not devotees, and on the one hand, and they can live in society also, and they are in a miserable condition indeed. So parents must be very sensitive to the their children. It won't, maybe some can want to add to all this.
As something to this, what you said in response, you mentioned that your guru told you that it's better you don't send your child to Mayapur Gurukul.
Yes, yes.
Can you please elaborate a little bit?
What?
Can you please elaborate a little bit why he considered it better that...
Yes, I think that our gurus have some vision which we don't have. And they somehow can understand what this person is like. And my son is from the very beginning very, very technical person. And I understood, in some time I understood that he came from the lowest heaven planets, yes, from robots, because it was very interesting during his the first days of love. He saw all life as a robots. I said him, it's a very nice cat. He said, no, it's a ferret with such a nice skin. This is a robot with such a nice skin. He saw all this world as a robot. And when one of my friend gave him robot construction, he was about 3 years old, and he made robots without any instructions. He understand how make robots. And I was programmer, and he couldn't read not English, not Russian. He was really small, maybe some 3-4 years ago. But he came to me and explained me how I must to do these things or others. I was astonished, really. And from 30 years, he was maybe the famous programmer in our town. He was 13, but he was the famous programmer in our town. And now he also is, and now he deals with robots. And he is very, very happy. And I think that my Guru Maharaj, he saw that this person has no inclination to devotion now. And he must pass through this way. But I think that life will give him some miserables, and he will change his and the first miserable he already have. He bought him a very expensive flat in Ukraine, and war started. And he worked very, very hard for this flat, and this is a very first impact for him, that yes, he spent a lot of money and for nothing.
It's broken?
Huh?
It got damaged?
No, it not got damaged, but he is abroad. His flat is in Ukraine and he lives abroad. And all these huge amounts are in vain.
I just want to say how, even though our families are the way they are, then there's a hope, because if the only thing actually that we can do for our family is that if we become one day a devotee of the Lord, then maybe you know better that I don't know how many generations in our family, in front and behind in the past, are liberated just because of that.
Yes.